Hi. Let's say you have a situation where an AI model is not treating people fairly. For example, a hiring model that's not treating people with neurodiversity fairly, or a model that awards loans, mortgages, is not treating a certain demographic group fairly. While every one of these situations is different, and there's a lot of nuance there, this sort of situation of not being fair generally stems from one particular issue, and that's what we're going to talk about today. But before we get into a specific example, let's take a look at kind of what models are and what they do. So models are based on what I like to call reality as we know it. So what exactly is reality as we know it? Reality is everything that's happened in the past and everything that's happening now. Something that happens next week, next month, next year isn't part of our reality because it hasn't happened yet. And what models are designed to do is AI models. They're designed to take this reality as we know it and create a mirror image of that. So for example, let's say you're doing cancer research and your mortality rate is 20%. So if you have a 20%, if reality is a 20% mortality rate, the mirror image of your reality should also have a 20% mortality rate. Likewise, if you're an organization and you have a 4% churn or cancellation rate, your mirrored image or your mirrored reality should also have a 4% churn rate. Well, it may not see this, but this is actually incredibly powerful, having a mirrored version of reality. For example, if you're doing cancer research and you can use this mirrored version of reality based on an AI model to come up with new drug treatments and possibly even bring this 20% mortality rate down to 10%. If you're an organization that's worried about your churn, you can use this mirrored reality to come up with different strategies that are going to allow you to mitigate churn. For example, let's say that we have an average of 4% churn rate, an average churn rate of 4%. So the average is 4%, but some people in your customer base are going to have a much higher likelihood to cancel. Some are going to have a much lower likelihood to cancel. And you can use this information to come up with better ways to keep them from canceling. Like, for example, these guys down here at 0%, they have like no chance of canceling. Do you want to spend a lot of money on them to try to keep them from canceling? Probably not, right? They're not going anywhere. Whereas these guys over here, these have a really high chance of canceling. So you can use your limited resources to reach out to these people and keep them from going anywhere. So by using this simulated reality or this mirror image of reality, organizations have the ability to make smarter decisions and have more and use their scarce resources more effectively, which ultimately leads to a higher profitability. Now that we understand what a model is and what it does, let's take a look at a specific example. This is Bob. Bob lives in Dallas, Texas. Bob owns a carpet cleaning business. Bob lives in Dallas, Texas, but he has customers in two different counties, Tarrant County, which is the county of Fort Worth, Texas, and Dallas County, which is obviously the county of Dallas, Texas. even though he does work in both counties, almost all of his outgoing marketing and his attempts to get new business has always been focused at in Dallas County. So because of that, his customer base is a little bit skewed. In Tarrant County, he has about 2% of his customers. And in Dallas County, he has about 98% of his customers. Also, his market penetration, which is the number of customers divided by the number of households in the county, for Tarrant County is about 0.2%, pretty low. And in Dallas County, it's about 2%. So if Bob builds a model over this reality as we know it, his mirrored reality will also have a market penetration rate of 0.2% for Tarrant County. And for Dallas County, his market penetration rate will be 2%. Again, because all the model's doing is creating a mirror image of reality as we know it. So based on this model, Bob wants to do some kind of outgoing marketing campaign. So based on this mirror image of reality, he wants to come up with a marketing campaign. It can really be anything. It could be calling people on the phone. It could be knocking on their door. It could be sending them a piece in the mail. It doesn't really matter. What's important is that Bob's going to use this model of a mirror image of reality, which creates a mirror image of reality, to come up with a marketing, a list of people to solicit that's going to have a higher ROI or is going to be more profitable than if he just mailed to everybody. Or solicited everybody, it's probably a better word. So based on this market penetration rate, some of people are going to have a 0% chance of becoming a customer of Bob's, and some are going to have a 100% chance of becoming a customer of Bob's. If we look at it at a county level, people in Tarrant County are going to have an average acquisition rate of 0.2%. And people in Dallas County are going to have an acquisition of 2%. So 0.2 versus 2%. All right. So let's just say that, you know, Bob, in order to maximize his ROI, he wants to set a cutoff. It will say 10%. So anybody greater than 10% has anybody that has a likelihood to become a customer greater than 10% based on this model, he wants to reach out to and try to solicit and try to get them to become a customer of his. So let's take a look at Dallas County. In order to cross this threshold of 10%, people in Dallas County have to be 5 times greater than average, right? Because the average, we'll say the average acquisition rate or the average probability to become a customer is 2%. So 10 divided by 2 is 5. Whereas for people in Tarrant County, it's not 5x, it's 50x. So they have to be 50 times greater than average. So you see what's going on here. In order to cross that 10% threshold, people in Tarrant County have to do a lot more work. And that's not really because of anything that people in Tarrant County did. They may love to become a customer of Bob's. It has to do with the fact of how Bob has approached this market historically. Historically, he hasn't given much time and effort to getting customers in Tarrant County. So guess what? Now that he's got a model to predict reality as we know it, not many people from Tarrant County are going to show up on his target list. So then the question becomes, is this what he wants? If he's happy to continue have a distribution between these counties of 98 and 2, yeah, that's fine. He's going to come up with everybody greater than 10% here. And most of those people are going to be in Dallas County. That's going to be fine. Where it becomes an issue is if he wants to change reality as he's known it in the past or as he knows it right now. If he wants to grow his customer base in Tarrant County, this ain't going to work because there's not going to be any prospects greater than 10% simply because they have a much higher bar to cross, 50 versus 5. So this is essentially what happens in a lot of situations that I referred to at the beginning. Because models are simply a mirror image of reality, if you've never hired people that have neurodiversity, models predicting people that are going to be good employees based on historical data aren't going to score people with neurodiversity very high. Likewise, if you have never given loans to a particular demographic group, that particular demographic group is not going to show up very highly in any kind of model you build on that historical data. So how do you fix this? You can't really fix it per se. There are some things you can do to mitigate it though. One thing you can do is you can set a different threshold. So in this case, Bob may set a threshold of 10% for people in Dallas County, but he may use 1% for people in Tarrant County. So each of them have the same kind of hurdle to climb, that same 5x, 1 divided by 0.2 equals 5. That's what most people do in these situations where they have data that's different than what they want to do going forward. Another tactic that you can use is you could mess around with the sample so that right now the sample of customers between Dallas and Tarrant County is, 50 to 1, basically. You could change that sample so it's closer to 50-50 or something like that by upsampling people in Tarrant County or downsampling people in Dallas County. That can also mitigate the issue. The third thing, which can work, but it rarely does, is you can change the model where you would not use, for example, county as a variable in your predictive model. That can work sometimes too, but it usually doesn't because of something called multicollinearity, but we won't get into that today. Anyway, hopefully this was helpful. Thanks so much for your time.